Morning.
How you doing?
Pretty good.
Appreciate you picking me over the exhibits and everyone else that's out there. I know it's, there's a lot going on right now. And my name's Steve Kerber. I'm the director of UL's newly formed Firefighter Safety Research Institute. Exciting time for me because I've actually got the backing of the company finally to let me keep doing what I'm doing and spend all of my time on firefighter stuff as opposed to a portion of my time and still have to do my real job. Really good. That's the way we've always done it. How many people have heard that before? How many got that as a response to a question? In many cases, probably a very basic question. Heard it a million times. Third generation firefighter, grew up in the firehouse, and from the moment that I first could say why, and they're dragging me around the firehouse, I was probably asking why, and I haven't stopped since. Been doing firefighter research for the last 10 years, and my mission all along the way is to, if that's the answer we're getting, we gotta do better. We gotta figure out actually why we're doing what we're doing. If the answer's a legitimate one, we keep doing it. The answer might be in a different direction. Maybe we start changing how we think about why we do things. And that's what we're gonna talk about this morning. Want to increase your knowledge of the changing fire environment. Everyone talks, things are different, blah, blah, blah. Well, let's break it down. Let's look at the components. Let's talk about how it's different and why that might matter. Reevaluate your tactical approaches. The fire environment's different. Multiple things are different. Maybe you want to do something different tactically. Maybe you don't. Maybe you think more and ask why. Became a chief at a very young age in a fairly busy fire department in Prince George's County, Maryland. Was commanding fires where probably every single person on the fireground was probably older than me. We had a really great program in College Park, Maryland, where pretty much we're rotating members every 4 years. They're coming to the University of Maryland to get a college education, and they're running the firehouse. So the average age in our firehouse is between 18 and 22. We also had townie members that hung around, so we had a good experience base to draw from and learn from. But the truth of the matter is, we're putting 20-year-old kids in the right front seat of a fire truck. We've got to download as much information in them that we possibly can so they know why they're doing what they're doing. 10 years in that system, become a chief. Don't have the big mustache. Don't have all the salty runs to hang my hat on. But the one thing I was going to be damn sure that I was doing is if I gave an order, I was going to have a reason why I was giving that order. They came out and started complaining. This is why I did that. This is the fire dynamics behind that. And we could get some pretty positive responses from that. And then give you the resources to facilitate change. Everything I'm going to talk about, I want you to be able to take home to your members and use in your departments. When this is over, at the UL booth, and I'll throw the booth number up after this, this entire presentation and all the videos are going to be on a disc that you can go grab. So be one of the first 250 people to the booth, grab the disc. There's a big difference between tactics and theory. Us engineers don't live in a bubble. Everything we do with the fire service. Practical applications must be developed by your department. If you have two guys on the first responding rig, if you've got six guys on the first responding rig, you've got small houses, big houses, all of these differences are extremely important, and we're going to talk about those differences. Engineers don't have all the answers, regardless of what some people might think when they read the first sentence of a report. We can't test every possible configuration, but we can begin to bound the problem. And that's where we're going to go. We're going to talk about variables to give you the right information. There aren't enough fires to make you an expert, so we need research to bridge the gap. It would be awful freaking cool if you could respond to a house fire, pick a set of tactics. All right, this one, I'm going through the front door, hitting that fire in the CD corner, we're going home, and I'll vent that window and throw this fan up and cut a hole in the roof. All right, well, that went pretty well. All right, but this time I'm going to rewind the tape, We're going to go back 2 hours. We're going to go back to the firehouse. We're going to do it again. Everything is exactly the same, except I'm going to pick a different tactic this time. You don't get that luxury. We can do that in research. We can only change one thing so we can understand the impact of that one thing. We want to make sure that you guys aren't guessing on the fire ground because you aren't quite sure what to do or what impact you're going to have on that fire. It's a really good time. If you didn't get the impression from the keynotes and from Bobby Halton and things like that, there's groups of people coming together that have never been together before the way they are right now. And we're learning from each other. The fire service, you guys are willing to sit in a room where the speaker's a fire protection engineer and not an old salty chief. Instead of going to some of those other choices, people like me are listening to the fire scientists, the guys that are really explaining the little flame stuff and looking at candles and stuff like that. And we're trying to take those theories and blow them up to full scale because the fire service wants the full scale answer. And we're going to look at it. We're going to get the right answers. I kind of try and live in this middle piece right here, not expecting you guys to go hang out with the fundamental fire scientists and things like that. We can improve the fire service a little piece at a time. We're doing a good thing. So as we go through this, I'm kind of taking feedback that I've heard from people around. And if at any point you hear never ventilate, never go inside, always throw water from the outside, never go over a basement fire, never vertically vent, everything you did in the past is wrong. If you hear any of those things at any point, listen harder. That is not what I'm saying at all. Hear the whole picture. What you should be hearing, it's rare that always and never apply. That's why we do that. Oh, cool. Start connecting incidents that you've been to in your head. That's where I want to be. I want your experience to matter. I want you to understand your experience. That could work for my department. If anything, right here, and I hesitate to throw that word aggressive up there because it drives me nuts, but people seem to gravitate towards it. If I can use this information to be more educated, that means I can be more aggressive than I ever have in the past to do the things that are important. Put the fire out faster and more efficiently, less chance to get hurt or killed, and a better chance for those victims to survive. That's what I want you to be hearing. That's what I want you to be connecting. All right, so we have a disturbing trend on our hands. A little more background. Those of you that came to the presentation yesterday saw these numbers. Traumatically inside structures, our death rate is going up. Overall, it's going down. We need to understand why this is, and we need to do better. Structure fires are going down. So if structure fires are going down, where are we getting our experience? What experience do we really have? How much do you really know about fire? And if you look at our system that we have in the United States, the answer is not a lot. And we need to fix this. We need to change this. These are the numbers from Maryland. You go through Firefighter 1, Firefighter 2, get your officer training, become a chief, get your chief training. You're looking at 1% or less of your actual training is on fire behavior. We're called firefighters. We know very little about fire in the grand scheme of things. We don't have the foundation that we need to make the proper decisions. So let's take a really broad look at the United States when we start talking about this experience thing. 1.1 million firefighters. Over the past 20 years, there's been 10 million structure fires. It's an average of 10 fires as the first due officer or the first due guy on the line in a 20-year career. What experience can you really gain going to 10 fires in 20 years? And I understand that many of you are above this. Many of you may be below this. Some of you may be volunteer departments where you don't live right next to the firehouse. You're never the first guy on the first rig. And you also kind of rotate through your career, especially if you're in a career department. You might move from an engine company to a truck company. You respond to one fire in a small house as an engine officer versus responding as that truck officer. You're looking at that fire very differently. So you're going to gain a different level of experience. You're still only going to see one piece of that fire. You may not holistically see that fire. So who do we listen to? Who has the experience? Well, it's the guy with the burnt helmet and the guy with the big mustache. In many cases. Who's got the biggest mustache in the room? Versus the smartest guy. And I say that jokingly, but it's kind of sad when you look at a firefighter recruit class. You got 30 sets of brand new eyes looking at you. And if you stand off to the side and look, and you try to figure out who they're paying attention to, chances are they're probably paying attention to not the guy with the clean gear, even though he might be the guy with the most experience to saying the right things. Their eyes are going to start wandering to the guy with the burnt-up helmet and the dirty gear. It's like nature. One of those things that we also have to break. All right, so what's changed? We've been doing this for 100 years. It's worked perfectly. Quit messing with me. Things are changing. Outside of your control, things are changing. The expectations of the fire service are changing. Technology's changing. The fire environment's changing. Fire service research is changing. And the pace of change is changing a lot more rapidly now than it used to. Let's look at all these. What's part of the reason that we don't get a lot of hours on fire behavior? You're expected to be experts in all of this. And in many cases, coming out of Firefighter 1 and Firefighter 2, you get so many topics thrown at you that you've never seen before, you might not be able to wrap your head around any of them. And the old concept was, oh, we'll just pair you up with a mentor in the fire station, you'll go to a bunch of fires together, you'll pick it up, you'll start to put the pieces together. Is that really happening today? In some cases, maybe, some cases, probably not. How many hours do you spend learning all these different tools and having to be an expert in all these different tools and subjects? It's tough. Paramedics. I don't know how the hell someone becomes really good at being a paramedic and really good at being a firefighter at the same time, because I don't know if my head has enough space to soak up all that stuff. Technology. I think we've done a really good job over time of giving ourselves the tools to protect ourselves, whether it's huge advancements in turnout gear, SCBA, tools, apparatus, you name it. It's all gotten better. But have we gotten to a point where essentially we've replaced the knowledge that we need and the education that we need with technology? Stop thinking, don't worry, I'm just going to encapsulate you so much that your window of safety is going to get larger because you can possibly screw up and I'll get you out of it. Well, and then we take that buffer of, I'm going to give you time to get out if things change quickly or unexpectedly, to every single fire, I'm going to push the boundaries of this equipment that I have. I'm going to push the boundaries of this technology. People say, well, if I had a bigger SCBA bottle, I could stay in longer and I'd never breathe smoke. I'd never take my mask off. My fiber alert went off. Well, if I just had an extra 15 minutes, or if I had an escape amount of air, I would have got out of that situation. Well, then you put an escape pack, extra little piece of air on that SCBA, and then what do firefighters start using it for? Not escape air, they use it for, oh, I can operate a little bit longer, so I'm going to go ahead and tap into my extra air. We're doing this to ourselves. And as Bobby Halton calls it, the interweb. There's a whole lot of information out there, and it's flowing like crazy. Some good, some not so good, some great. Everyone can voice their opinion. I don't have to talk anymore about that. You guys all get it. But I want you to look at this right here when we start talking about technology. Risk emerges when technological change is not accompanied with appropriate prior scientific investigations or post-release surveillance of the resulting impacts. We're really good at just releasing stuff into the wild and letting people make up their own use for it, letting people figure it out on the fly. It's expensive to do R&D in many cases. And we can really get ourselves into trouble when we don't do a really good job of understanding the technology, understanding its limitations, understanding its uses, instead of just figuring them out on the fly. Past devices not working when they heat up. Radios not working when the speaker mic gets too hot. Things like, we should have figured that out. We shouldn't have to kill firefighters to figure that out. Let's talk about the changing fire environment. Look at this, I tricked you into a formula. Silly engineer. Larger homes, open spaces, evolving fuel loads, more void spaces, changing building materials and new technologies. This stuff is coming at you from all different angles. It's not just one thing that's changing, your whole fire environment is changing. Every one of these poses different problems for you, and when you start combining them, they're creating problems that we don't maybe even quite understand yet. One thing for sure, we're seeing faster fire propagation, shorter times to flash over, rapid changes in fire dynamics, shorter escape times, shorter times to collapse, and unknown hazards. Solar panels. Did a huge project on solar panels. There were hazards there that I would never even have thought of until we got into that project. Home size, 1,600 square feet to 2,600 square feet. Who's got resources that have kind of tracked the hazard? It's probably gone the other way, right? Cutting resources, cutting staffing. You don't need it anymore. Look at this. 26% of the houses built in 2008 were greater than 3,000 square feet. Big problems. Open spaces. This is one that I'm getting more and more of an appreciation of. Especially when we start talking about flow paths and things like that, which those of you that were in here for Dan's presentation before that, the open spaces make a huge change in how fire moves and spreads through the house. The old floor plan that we're used to, every single room is cut off from another room by a doorway or small openings. When we start talking about how important it is to get air to that fire, to allow that fire to increase. When that fire has to come out of a doorway to move from room to room, it's extremely difficult to spread that fire from room to room. When you remove the walls, you now have big, giant open spaces. You don't have the doorways that are going to cut off or slow down that oxygen supply to the fire anymore. It's got a wide open avenue. When we start taking down walls, making archways, making two-story spaces, all of these things, we're changing how the water interacts with the fire because the volumes are going to be bigger. We're changing how the fire can move and spread through the structure. It has a big impact. Great rooms. Put atriums in our houses. How your water is going to convert to steam in that room is very different than an 8-foot ceiling. Very different. Open foyers. You get up above a fire in an open foyer, your chance of fighting your way back down that stairwell are very slim. Taller ceilings, open floor plans. All these things. If you can see line of sight, that fire can spread line of sight if it gets the oxygen. Fuel loads. Everyone wants to talk about the fuel loads. Extremely important. Been changing since the 50s. Plastics have been around a long time. Difference is the saturation today is very different than it used to be. So, Dan and I saw on a test in Spartansburg, foam from 20 years ago is very different from the foam that you might come across today. So if someone says polyurethane foam from 20 years ago, it's been around forever. What are you talking about it now? We had a sofa that burned slowly with polyurethane foam because it was an older, denser foam. Today, lighter, less dense, more surface area, more air availability, faster burn rates. Got a really cool setup at UL. We've got probably one of the largest fire labs in the U.S., if the world. It's actually the largest land-based elevator in the United States. It's a 100 by 100 aircraft carrier deck that is the ceiling for our test lab. So if I want an 8-foot ceiling or if I want a 50-foot ceiling, I've got four giant hydraulic rams that can move that 100 by 100 ceiling wherever I need it to be. We can simulate any warehouse configuration anywhere. It also, when it's not being used for other testing, becomes my playground. So we start small. We build a couple rooms. We've got a modern room on the left, legacy room here. Modern furniture that you would just go to the store and buy today. Go to your local retail store. Your flat panel TV. And then we've got our cotton-filled sofa over here. We took grandma's plastic off the seat, so we kind of exposed it a little bit. Don't have a console TV. We couldn't find one of them, but we got a tube TV. Young kids used to have, like, depth to the televisions. Plastic kids' toys versus wooden kids' toys. And here we go. Legacy room on the left, modern room on the right. How many people have seen this video? Outstanding. We're finally getting there. We're getting close. Light it up on the left, or on the right-hand side of the sectional sofa. Light it up on the right-hand side of the sectional sofa. Right off the bat, you see a very different color of smoke. Why is the smoke in the modern room so black? What's burning?
Hydrocarbons.
Foam, root material, crude oil, incomplete combustion. See how the fire melts through the sofa and starts burning on the bottom too? Now we're burning on multiple surfaces. Now we can release twice as much energy as we can when it's just burning on the top. Go to flashover, 3 minutes, 40 seconds. What's the average response time of a fire department in the United States? It's about 6 minutes. This is happening before you get there. It gets a little dark. My 120 by 120 lab, my lights sit 20 feet off the floor in a 60-foot ceiling. This room filled the lab with smoke down to the height of the lights. 29 and a half minutes. Firefighting has never been easy, never will be, but your timeline is shrinking remarkably. All right, so we step it up a notch. It was fun to build two rooms, let's build two houses. So here we have two 1,200 square foot ranch houses side by side. Legacy on the left, modern on the right. The only difference between these two houses is these two sofas, and there's a couple chairs here, and these two sofas. Everything else is the same. Carpet's the same, walls are the same, wood furniture's the same, television's the same. These are made of natural materials, these are made of synthetic materials. We're going to let them go until they become ventilation limited. Watch the smoke showing out of the house up here. We're pushing. What happened? Became ventilation limited, ran out of air, and then it starts looking for air. So it starts trying to pull air in through any crack it can possibly find. We're chugging away over here. When it gets to 8 minutes over here, it's been ventilation limited, so we're going to go ahead and give it air through the front door and the front window. Coordinated fire attack, except the piece of the coordinated fire attack we're going to leave out is the water. We're going to let it go to flash over just to see how long it takes. Fire gets the air, get a tunnel of air that goes in through the front, and our flow path changes. flow path goes from fresh air into what's burning to overwhelming that flow path, and now the flow path is just at the openings. And we're chugging away. Chugging away. In all reality, with the oxygen concentration, the CO, and the temperature, you could sit on this sofa and watch that at this point. We are extremely far past that in today's fire environment. Notice the smoke is kind of a white, wispy smoke. It doesn't have a thickness to it. It's not dense and black. Natural materials burn a little more completely until it starts to run out of oxygen, which happens in about the 20 minute mark. So right now, we're oxygen concentration's dropping. 24 minutes, we're going to go ahead and open it up. Front door open, 24 minutes, 24:15, the front window opens. Same scenario as over here. Get some rollover. You're going to see my technician come over and talk to me. We're trying to figure out whether or not it's going to go to flashover or not. He's going to want to go get a closer look, and as he goes to get a closer look, it actually goes to flashover. I think I lost the bet for lunch there. I was trying. And in many cases, it's getting the carpet going, and it gets these two chairs going, which really drive it to flashover. It actually gets some synthetic energy and gets going. Look at our time differences. 4 times longer to run out of air, and almost 4 times longer to respond to the air. And that bottom one, I think, is extremely important. Not to say, I hate to use the word forgiving, but pretty much, if you look at a coordination window that you need to be within in order to coordinate your operation, you got a 2 minute window to flash over here, probably about a minute and a half before things are actually worse than they were than when you showed up. Over here, it's a different ballgame. You do get a smoke layer lift. Over here, you kind of get some tunneling. You don't really get that lift. Over here, when you ventilate, it actually lifts the smoke in the back rooms. Over here, we didn't lift any smoke in the back rooms. It stayed dark to the floor everywhere else other than between where you provided the vent and where that oxygen was being consumed, your flow path. One of the few graphs I'm going to show you, because I think there's some really neat differences here. The blue temperature is the modern temperature in the living room. It hits 1100 degrees Fahrenheit before it runs out of oxygen. Versus the legacy only hits about 400 or a little more than 400 before it runs out of oxygen. It dies down. We drop from 1100 degrees down to 400 degrees, and then we ventilate and we go back up to 1800 degrees. Over here, we ventilate. It drops to about 250. It chugs along. It's trying, and it finally hits flashover. We're at about 1600 degrees. So when you start talking about, well, fires are hotter today, temperature-wise, well, maybe. This says it might be true, 1,800 degrees instead of 1,600 degrees. Does that really matter to you? Absolutely not. It's how quickly it gets there. Here we're getting there in 2 minutes. Here we're getting there in 8.5 minutes. Look at the oxygen concentrations. We dropped to 5% before we recovered. And then when we're involved, we drop 2%. Legacy, we're running out of oxygen. We're still in the 18% ballpark, not the 5% ballpark. Our pendulum isn't swinging so fast that it overshoots and swings back. So the responsiveness to that oxygen is going to be very different because of the oxygen concentrations we're dealing with. All right, let's continue through our fire formula. Void spaces. When we start taking the mass out of our construction materials and start making things like parallel cord trusses and things like that, we create void spaces that weren't there previously. You now get an electrical fire in a void space in your ceiling, and where it can only spread in one direction, can now spread in all directions. And it's got more oxygen, and it's got more surface area for burning. Attics. If you were to design a scenario to burn an attic off a house, this is how you would do it. You'd make a teepee shape, you'd let air in low, and you'd let hot gases out high. That's how our attics work, because you've got to keep them vented so that they don't build up moisture and things like that. Some of this is changing. However, you'd also fill it with really thin pieces of wood with a lot of surface area. Well, that's what we're doing now. A lot of surface area, a lot of ventilation, bad situation for an attic fire. Sheathing. This is one that I'm studying right now that's driving me a little nuts. We've gone from plywood to OSB to asphalt fiberboard to cardboard, and now we're using foam as a sheathing material. What's the purpose of sheathing? Well, it keeps the house from racking and falling apart. If your sheathing's rigid enough and the foam is rigid enough, you can use it as your outer layer, and then you just cover it with vinyl siding or some other decorative shake or things like that. You're going to start seeing more exterior fires that are well advanced beyond what you've seen in the past. And of course, we've got some incidents to start to address that. Top picture. This is a vinyl shake sheathing over top of a polystyrene sheathing. On the right is the cedar plank, which is a legacy material, something you've probably seen for some time. Both of these are 2 minutes after the first picture. So we put a little fire source here, 100 kilowatt burner, and 2 minutes later, this thing's fully involved. It pools on the ground, it makes a bigger fire on the ground. 2 minutes over here, this fire never extended into where the eave line would be. These are 8-foot by 8-foot walls. Linings. Here's another one that gets overlooked sometimes. We move from plaster and lath to gypsum board. Plaster and lath had no seams. Gypsum board has seams. Every 4x8 or every 4x12. And we go ahead and we take drywall compound or spackle and tape it and mud the seams so it looks nice and flat. There's no inherent fire resistance for drywall compound. It heats up, it falls out. When it heats up and it falls out, it opens up a gap into the wall. What's behind gypsum board? Paper and wood, right? So now we go ahead, we get into the wall cavity, and now we have a structure fire. These are things when you start comparing construction practices between, say, the Europeans and ourselves, these are things we deal with because we've allowed them to happen to ourselves that they don't necessarily have to deal with because they're building with solid construction, block and brick, plaster and lath and things like that, where we've moved on from that to make it lighter and cheaper. New growth lumber is here, old growth lumber, engineered I-joists. That had too much material, so we cut the web out so we can run ductwork and wires and things like that. Metal C-joists, parallel core trusses. All of these things have huge mechanical advantages to old dimensional lumber. First off, we've used most of this that we have. We've used ours, we've used Canada's, and we don't have that much wood left. So we go ahead and we grow new growth lumber. Why are the growth rings so far apart? Grows really fast. Less density. They figured out ways to perfectly space the trees apart and to feed them hormones and things like that and to give them the perfect amount of sun and shading and things like that to grow that lumber as quick as they possibly can to go ahead and mill it and get it out into the houses. The construction industry has actually acknowledged the fact that the strength of the modern wood, especially when it gets built into trusses, isn't what they originally hoped it would be when they first started cutting the stuff down, which was actually solid dimensional lumber. And this pretty much shows that they've got market share. You can get a nice, true, straight floor, 40-foot span, because these things can span a heck of a lot more distances than you could with older dimensional lumber. Why do we have open spaces? Why can we have open spaces and open floor plans? We don't need columns and bearing walls anymore. Not important anymore. Okay, well, we've got these joists that can go ahead and span it, so you don't need a bearing wall. Insulation. I got a couple pictures here of attic insulation. You've got your traditional vented attic where the insulation is above the ceiling of the living space. A trend that's happening now is they're insulating the underside of the deck and essentially making that attic area condition space of the house. How does that impact fire behavior and fire growth, especially if you get a fire in the attic space? Well, we went to Delaware County, Pennsylvania, to the Emergency Services Training Center there, and I'm not going to go through all the tests that we did, but I want to show you some interesting fire behavior that we saw. So this is the foam-insulated attic. We start a fire in the attic space. We've got a 4x4 hole cut out here, and we have a piece of 5/8 inch plywood laying over top of that hole to keep it shut, and then we have it rigged up that I can pull a vertical vent hole without having to put people on the roof. It's pushing pressure out around those gaps. I've got probes in the opening, so it's not 100% flush with the roof. And we start talking about increased heat release rate creates higher pressures. Pressures go from high to low. Here's a great example of that. So as that fire is burning that foam in the attic, I begin to see things that I've never seen before. If you look close enough, it's lifting that 5/8 inch sheet of plywood a foot off that roof deck. And then you want to talk about changing size up. It didn't burn itself out, but it came pretty darn close. You pull up on that versus what you saw 30 seconds prior, you got a very different picture in your head. Windows are changing, going from single glaze to double glaze, wood frame, vinyl frame. They fail very differently, and I'm not going to spend a lot of time talking about that. Doors, going from solid core to hollow core, and now we're molding doors out of wood pulp. So when we start talking about compartmentation and things like that, the time you would have with a solid core door is very different than what you're going to have today with a hollow core door. Even the hollow core door, in many cases, will give you about 5 minutes. One of the interesting things we saw here was, if you've got a solid core door, by the time you finish making it decorative, by cutting the 6 panels into both sides of the door, so you've got a nice decorative door, you've got about the same amount of wood where you cut it as you would with a hollow core door. So you have, newsflash, wood burns, and it burns depending on how thick it is, and we burn through the panels at about the same time that we burn through the hollow core of the composite door. New technologies, PV systems. Again, Delaware County, Pennsylvania, one of my favorite places to go. We get to build full PV systems on roofs and light them up. It's awesome. Many hazards associated here. You can't turn the systems off. That's number one. If you shut down the power to the inverter and you shut down the disconnects, everything from the panels in the wiring is still hot if the sun is up or if there's any light in the sky. And if you show up and you set up your light tower, you can still generate enough power to get lock-on voltage to someone that comes in contact with one of those wires. I'll give you resources to go to our website and see more about that. Smaller lots. So not only are we building homes bigger, but we're also making lots smaller and putting them closer together. We've gone from a 10,100 square foot average to an 8,800 square foot average. There's a lot of big home lots out there. It's hard to move that number. And that moved pretty substantially in 30 years. You're going to start seeing more and more instances of trade-offs and things like that, where the fire department shows up, exposures becomes really obvious because each house on either side of the one you're responding to is already on fire. You get into almost a wildland urban interface situation where you've got multiple houses going and you've got to deal with that. Didn't used to have to deal with that. The other piece is you're probably even going to have to deal with this in sprinkler communities. You sprinkler the inside of homes because sprinklers are life safety systems. They're meant to get the occupants out of the house. The fire starts on the outside or on the rear porch or in the garage. You may not have sprinklers. Chances are you're not going to have sprinklers. That fire goes up the outside with all that plastic sheathing and siding and stuff we talked about and gets into the attic space before you even get there. And that attic is set up to burn pretty well. That attic gets going. That makes a whole lot of radiation. It gets the neighbor's house going. Again, outside of the sprinkler systems. So you're going to overwhelm the sprinkler system that has piping in the attic and essentially start moving down the block, even though you've got a sprinkler community. And the home builder may have gotten trade-offs from the fire marshal to allow the homes to be built closer together because they have sprinkler systems. So now we're going ahead and we're creating a series of issues compounding each other with all these considerations. So here, this pretty much sums up the workplace. Houses are getting smaller, houses are getting bigger, lots are getting smaller, fuel loads are changing, layouts are changing, building materials are changing. Have your staffing, training, tactics changed to adapt to these changes? Doesn't need an answer. Think about it. You all have a different answer to that question, probably. Firefighter research has changed. And one of the big reasons it's changed is because of Department of Homeland Security funding. Most companies and most universities, it's hard to get money to do firefighter research. The Department of Homeland Security, through the Assistance to Firefighter Grant Program, part of the Fire Prevention and Safety section, part of the research section, so we're a sub of a sub of a sub of a sub, they set a little bit of money aside for people to compete for to do firefighter research. And most of what I'm going to show you would not have happened if it wasn't for the support of that program. Finally, I'm getting to the point where UL is backing this and funding this, even if we don't get a grant, to keep this stuff going because they see how important it is. But if this funding dries up, the majority of the firefighter research is going to dry up. You're not going to see stuff like this anymore. Dan and I are going to start having trouble getting enough resources put together to do something new to come show you guys. Firefighting Technology Group, which Dan talked about, they're constantly getting beaten and having staffing reduced and things like that because they're not robots and they're not nanoparticles and things like that. They're niche, neat, new, fundamental research stuff. So it's becoming a really difficult to survive in. UL's been lucky enough to be awarded one of these grants every year since the program started. Plus, we've got a couple other projects, like a project from NIST, as well as the Governor's Island Research. The ones in red are the ones I'm going to talk about. So I'm going to talk about horizontal ventilation, I'm going to talk about basement fires, I'm going to talk about vertical ventilation, and then we're going to talk a little bit about the Governor's Island stuff. Quick overview of each of these projects. Horizontal ventilation. 15 full-scale houses, 1,200 square foot ranch house versus 3,200 square foot colonial house. We got the opportunity to look at the difference of fire growth in newer layouts versus older layouts. And ultimately, we try and have all of these result in tactical considerations. things for you to think about. We take the million data points and thousands of hours of video, boil it down, and try and give you things that you can learn from or try to incorporate into your practices. So you can see the topics here that came out of the horizontal ventilation project, and you can see the houses on the side here. Basement fires. We conducted this with NIST. Then we looked at everything from furnace testing to field testing to lab testing to full house testing that we did with partnership with the Chicago Fire Department, where we got an older 40s home and a 2000s home and essentially burnt them to the ground, looking at the difference of basement collapse and fire spread from the first floor to the basement. All kinds of information. You can see some of the tactical considerations that came out of that. I'm going to give you places to go to get all this information. Vertical ventilation. This is one that we're wrapping up right now. It's going to be released in June, where we went back to the same two houses. Again, repeatability. How do I compare horizontal to vertical if I'm not using the same geometry and similar fuel loads? You're going to start seeing talk about the limitations of vertical ventilation. You're going to see the good stuff with vertical ventilation. You're going to talk about coordination, hole size, location, door control. We showed you the modern versus the legacy comparison. A lot of conversation about flow path. And I'll give you a little teaser. Most of you are probably going to be really pissed off when you see the results of the vertical ventilation tests. And here's why. Because I'm not going to tell you whether or not vertical ventilation is good or bad. I'm going to tell you how to look at the variables to make your own decision as to what it does in this scenario, what it does in that scenario, how it gets impacted by flow paths, how the horizontal ventilation impacts the vertical ventilation, how the hole size may change certain things. I'm not going to tell you don't vertically ventilate. I'm not going to tell you always vertically ventilate. I'm going to give you all of the stuff that you need to make that decision for yourself, based on your resources, your priorities, and things like that. I'm going to try and make you smarter to generate the knowledge that you need that's important to you. And then, of course, the Governor's Island. Those of you that were there yesterday, thank you very much. It was a great project, a great partnership, and I think it's going to lead to a whole lot of things. I know it's certainly leading to change within the New York City Fire Department as they refine some of their tactics. I don't know necessarily that they're really changing anything. They're making some, increasing some knowledge, putting some training out, making guys really appreciate the impact of the ventilation and the suppression that they do. All right, so let's start talking some tactic stuff. As a whole, the fire service knows very well how to ventilate, but not necessarily what, where, when, and why. And this goes back to the whole 1% of your training is fire behavior. We teach the how of ventilation really good because it's sexy. We're going to get on this roof prop all day long, and we're going to make 7, 8, 9 cuts and kerf cuts and trench cuts and everything else because it's fun to do. It's visual. It keeps the students engaged. They're really good at the how. How often do you have a discussion of, well, what's the impact of that cut going to be? What if the fire's in the attic? What if the fire's in the living space? What happens when you push down the ceiling? How does that change conditions? In most cases, we don't know the answer to that. That's why we did the vertical ventilation project. The training material doesn't tell you what's going to happen. They say, well, it kind of makes sense to vent near the fire. And I kind of suggest making a 4x4 hole, and then they kind of softened that and said, well, a minimum of a 4x4 hole, but I'm not going to tell you how big of a hole to make, because we don't know the answers. It's part of an issue with some of our training materials, which is why this research is so important, because it's going to begin to allow you to understand why and when and the timing that's necessary. And things like that that all come into play. As opposed to, you go ahead and everybody gets their own experience, which may match, may not match. Fire service, if you're a fire officer, how many of you fire officers have been asked a question by a younger member as to why you did something in the fireground or why the fire reacted the way it did? And you're really good at making up a story that sounds plausible. Been there. Absolutely. It might have been true. It might not have been true, but the truth in your head is, I think that's why. We're trying to give you guys the data and the considerations and the video and things like that so you can start matching what's happening under controlled conditions into what you're seeing in the field. It's all about marrying that experience to what we know is happening as opposed to what we're guessing is happening. All right, where do we train on ventilation? Well, we've got these concrete training buildings with our high temperature linings, with our pallets in our hay or Excelsior or whatever you use, which is phenomenal for repeated burns, right? I need this thing to last 30 years, and I need to put a million recruits through it, and we need to let them see limited visibility, we need to let them feel a little bit of heat, we need them to stretch hose lines without being able to see very well, we need them to learn to ventilate. When you put pallets and hay in a room, in a concrete building, what type of fire do you have? You have a fuel-controlled fire. What happens when you ventilate a fuel-controlled fire?
How big does that building?
It gets better 100% of the time. Because it's got all the air it wants already to burn. So the smoke layer's going to lift. The heat's going to dissipate. Visibility's going to get better 100% of the time. Even if you make the opening in the wrong spot, wrong size, wrong timing, bad coordination, it's always going to get better. So the only way we have to tell reality and to explain reality to these young guys that have no idea what they're looking at and gals is to have a sharp instructor standing there saying, this isn't the way it's really going to happen. Here's how it's going to happen. The timing needs to be coordinated. So if you go ahead, you do an evolution, and the window opposite the fire gets opened up 2 minutes before the hose line gets in there to start having an impact, you need to explain the fact that you need to coordinate tighter than that. This is what could happen. If there's a 2 minute lag, this room splashed over, the fire spreading to this room, any victims that are in here, you didn't do them any favors. However, what they're going to see with their eyes is, oh, the smoke lifted, it was great for the engine crew, they just came right in here, they had good visibility. It was good for everyone. So when they get in the field, what's in their head? Ventilate equals cooling, heat lifting, everything gets better. If anything, I bet you we have a bunch of instructors operating in these buildings all over the country that probably yell at the students if they don't ventilate more or ventilate faster or make that smoke lift or get the roof hatch open and things like that. Not really understanding what's going on with the timing and things like this. We've proven we can't be trusted to do anything much more realistic than this. We've killed firefighters. We've killed firefighters in these. It's completely unacceptable, so there's a reason 1403 exists. It's not completely limiting us, not allowing us to see realistic fire. We did that to us. You can't drag sofas in here. And even if you could, you still wouldn't get the same conditions because you've got cold concrete block walls. It's going to behave differently. So we got to bridge the gap somehow. I think the stuff that we're doing is trying to give you the tools to help bridge the gap between the videos and the training programs and things like this. Truth of the matter is, you can't just flash it over on some students. And I don't know that I would trust that even if you could in an acquired structure have realistic fuel loads, that we could trust our people to do it safely with the proper instruction. There's tons of great instructors out there that would do that with no problem. However, I don't think we're quite there. I think that we need to get closer to that, but I think we really need to be able to describe a set of conditions that can be used to make that work. And then, of course, we've got our flashover simulator. We put students in here, and we demonstrate to them, essentially, gas is burning. And without proper instruction, without good instructors, they think they were in a flashover. They think they can survive a flashover. They think they can crawl under a flashover. In many cases, without good instructors, with the proper information, we're doing more harm than good. We're sending the wrong message. So when you do get that kid that's going to his first of his 10 fires that he's going to have in his career, how much of this is he drawing back on to make his decisions that may have been wrong from the absolute onset? I don't know. Here's a look at the two houses. So you can see the great room in three dimensions, all the furniture that we had throughout the house. And then here's a sped up video that shows you that we're instrumenting every room, we're measuring temperatures and gas concentrations throughout the house, and most importantly, we're providing you visuals of things that you never get to see in reality. You don't get to see what's going on before you arrive. We're giving you the opportunity to see what's going on before you arrive. What is the victim in that back bedroom potentially experiencing? That's what they would be seeing if they were sitting next to that bed with their head on the floor. You can see the fire become ventilation limited and run out of oxygen. You can see the conditions go black in all the rooms. You can see what you would experience if you were behind a closed door in a bedroom much better than the one below it, which is an open door. You can see the impact of opening the door or opening a window. What would happen if we opened that window? What happened if we put a hole in the roof? What would happen if we opened the back window? We can do all these things, and we've done them for you, and we're giving you the material to learn from. Do you see the smoke lift in these back rooms once the ventilation gets made? You don't, because they're not in the flow path. They don't get the oxygen into those back rooms. Those of you that saw Dan earlier, this is really important. You have a room like this out in the open. This is what your fire growth curve looks like. Ignition, growth, fully developed, decay. That's really what we're doing in our firefighter training buildings. We can't do this in our firefighter training buildings, where you get growth, then you get a decay stage, then there's a ventilation, and then you get growth, and then it's fully developed, and then you get decay. That's what happens when you take this and put it in a structure and ventilate the structure. This is even too simple. Here's a fire growth curve where two things happen. The front door gets open, and a hole gets cut in the roof. It's important to know that there isn't one growth stage. There isn't one decay stage. There isn't one fully developed stage. Don't get thrown off by all this stuff. It's actually pretty simple. The fire ignites. It grows. At some point, it transitions from a fuel-limited fire to a ventilation-limited fire. As it makes that transition, it's running out of oxygen, and then you get your first decay stage, or your initial decay stage. From this point on, we're ventilation limited. We're now producing more fuel than we have oxygen to burn. We get our initial decay. An event takes place. That event happens to be ventilation. In this case, we open the front door. Then we get a second growth stage. At some point during that growth stage is flashover. Flashover is not a stage of fire growth. It's an event. It's a momentary event that takes place during that growth stage, and that growth stage continues. At some point, when we've got fire completely coming out of that front door, and that flow path only exists at the front door, you got flames coming out of the front door, you see air going in low, flames coming out of the top, it's burning there because it ran out of oxygen, and that's the only place it can find the oxygen. That's fully developed. It can't get any bigger. It's responded to the oxygen. It hit a peak. So now we're in our first fully developed stage. So the fire is invented. It's venting. You give it more air. In this case, we vent the roof. We get another growth stage. More fire, more energy is being produced. And then once we've got fire coming out of the front door and fire coming out of the roof, we hit a fully developed stage again. So we've got a new fully developed stage that is above the other fully developed stage because we're burning more now. And then we go ahead and we hit it with some water, and then we get to the decay stage. What would happen if we went ahead and took that window out after we made the roof vent? We'd come up again, another growth stage, another fully developed stage, until we get water on it, or we run out of fuel, one or two, and then we get to the decay stage. I think we have a lot of folks out there that believe when the fire's showing from the structure, it's vented, we're all good. It's coming out. Well, you're all good because you know where it is, but if you keep making openings to a ventilation-limited fire, you will keep having fire coming out of the openings. Here's a fire we had in Prince George's County that my company was third new engine on. If there was a bread and butter house fire, this is the bread and butter house fire. Very small ranch house. Engine and truck crew arrive almost simultaneously. Little smoke showing. Cakewalk. Truck crew gets their masks on, force the front door, they go in, they start a search. They're coordinating with the hose line, right? It's right here. It's ready to go. Well, the lineman from the engine crew took his 100-foot shoulder load and dumped it in the porch area. He didn't have enough time to flake it out by the time he got water. So he gets water, and now he's got 100 feet of tangled, knotted spaghetti. He's not getting water to the nozzle. He doesn't communicate this to the truck crew inside. They're focused on getting water, things like that. The only fuel load in this entire house happened to be vacant, was a sofa and an end table in the living room. It's the only thing that was in the entire house. All right, I've got a truck crew inside. I'm having trouble getting the line in place. I think, what do we need to do to cool it off for that truck crew inside? Well, let's ventilate more. So we go ahead and take out the sliding glass door in the front. More air. Air really close to where the fire wanted that air, and it responds very quickly. This 2 minutes is 2 minutes after this picture. We have two firefighters in the rear of the structure searching the bedrooms that are lucky enough to orient themselves in the right direction, run through the fire, hit this wall right out here in front, and have another crew pull them up and out of the porch area, essentially on fire. They got some burns, but they survived. They got lucky. We should have been going to a funeral for this in all intents and purposes. They didn't get water to the line. Once they get water, they knocked the fire down with a hole that was in the hose line, either from a piece of glass or from the heat, directed that into the fire and knocked the fire down. It doesn't take a lot of water to knock out these ventilation-limited fires. Forcing the front door is ventilation. Here's another one that we've overlooked for some time. Do we teach fire behavior with forcible entry? Probably almost never. However, a doorway is the best possible way to ventilate a ventilation-limited fire. It goes all the way to the ground, which is ideal, so your air can go in low and some hot gases can come out high. It's one of the most efficient ways we have to grow a fire. So if you've got a ventilation-limited fire, which we had in the one-story house and the two-story house, from the moment the front vent gets open until flashover, you're looking at like 60 seconds to 2.5 minutes, depending on a couple variables, just by opening the front door. Do we ever show up, chop the front door open before the hose line's ready to go? All the time. Do we show up as chiefs, want to see what conditions we have, pop the front door, and leave it open? Of course we do. Do we have cops that get that front door open all the time before we get there because they happen to be around the corner? Do we get neighbors that find ways to get doors open? Absolutely. Best way to grow a fire. Who knows how long that door's been open? Maybe the occupant left it open. Maybe they forced it open. The fire's not going to wait for you to get your line together and get your mask on. It's going to respond to that oxygen. Oh, we don't need that. Never mind. So what if we were to control the front door? We always don't have front door, there's the fire. It's not always that easy. Sometimes you've got to advance into the structure to go ahead and put the fire out. If you can delay the chance that it becomes a race between how fast you can get in there and how fast the air can get in there, if you're not really tight with your 90 seconds, you want to do everything you can to limit the oxygen going in through that front door. So even if you have a hose line going in through that front door, straight in, and you still leave the door open about a foot and a half, that two-thirds that you're blocking that opening has a really positive impact on slowing that fire growth down. Kind of gives you yourself a little bit of a buffer. Here's what that looks like. The one on the left, we force it all the way open, allow the hose crew to go in, and then we pull it closed so it's only open so a 2-inch line can go straight through the front door. The one on the right, we just kick it all the way open.
How big is the gap on the door on the left?
The gap on the door is about a foot and a half.
Same fire load.
Same fire load, everything else is identical. So what does that look like? Well, we also combine this with a vertical ventilation test. The way we triggered vertical ventilation was as soon as we hit 400 degrees Fahrenheit at 3 feet, at your head where it would be extremely hot. So what we saw, from the door wide open to the door control, there was about a 3-minute lag in reaching 400 degrees at 3 feet. That's an extra 3 minutes of getting water on that fire. In the two-story, we've got a fire in the back of the house, so the door is further away from where the fire is. Longer flow path for that air to take to get to the fire. We thought the fire was going to go out when we controlled the door. Versus wide open, we went 400 degrees. In about 12 minutes, versus leaving the door controlled, thought the fire was going to put itself out. So we wound up opening it all the way to continue to grow it so we could do the vertical ventilation piece of the test. Door control is a temporary action. I recommend, whoever the guy is you have at the front door pinch point, advancing line, as one hand on the doorknob controlling the door, and the other hand he's feeding line into the crew. Any little bit, whether it's half or two-thirds or whatever, that he's stopping that oxygen from going in through that front door, he's buying that crew time to put water on the fire. Once water gets on the fire, open the door. That's when you're winning the battle. It's all about winning the battle. The fire's going to create a certain amount of energy. If you're taking away more energy with your hose line than that fire is creating, vent your heart out. Open it up, you've won the battle, the smoke will lift. If that fire is producing more energy, then you're taking away, and you ventilate, conditions will get worse. It's all about that heat release rate. It's all about that ventilation limit. Door control is not only for hose line advancement. I'm not suggesting you search ahead of the hose line, but if you have to, and I understand there's conditions where you may have to, my kid is in that room right there, and you're going to go by way of the interior, one of the best things you can possibly do is control that door behind you. That way it's not a race. If you can buy yourself 3 extra minutes or more to get that victim and get them out before it flashes on you because you don't have any means to slow it down, you don't have a hose line, this is a tool to consider. It's not only for the front door. If you're moving your way through a house, every door that you can control, you can cut yourself off from the flow path and buy yourself plenty of time to search the area you're in. Or if things go to shit on you and you need to get out and you can get between where the fire is and a closed door, you're going to buy yourself all kinds of time because you're not the flow path anymore. People get concerned about the door relatching and things like that after you force it. Use a tool. If it's only open a little bit, you're doing a heck of a lot of good. Rate of change. This is one thing that we saw over and over again. We've seen it in my tests. We've seen it in Governor's Island. We've seen it in Spartansburg. We've seen it all over the place. It's a constant that keeps happening. You get this lull period where the fresh air enters and it mixes with the ventilation limited conditions that are in that house. And the moment things start to go bad, they go bad in an absolute hurry. We're talking from 100 degrees to 2,000 degrees in 10 seconds. Gets bad really fast. Betting near the seat of the fire versus far from the seat of the fire. Again, it all comes down to flow paths. The closer you vent to the seat of the fire, the faster that fire will grow. The faster you provide that oxygen to the fire, the faster it will grow. The closer you vent to the seat of the fire, and the faster you put water on the fire, the faster you let the heat out. So in our books, when it says vent near the seat of the fire, the reason it's saying that is because it's assuming that you're controlling the fire with water. That's when you want to let the hot stuff out as quickly as possible, the nearest you can to the seat of the fire. Venting far from the seat of the fire. If you want to spread the fire to a different part of the structure, provide that as a flow path. Vent that back window. Eventually, this fire will go back this way because fire is nothing more than pressure phenomenon. It's going to flow from a higher pressure to a lower pressure. The moment you give it the low pressure in the back of the house, it's going to take longer for this fire to go to flashover if you vent back here, because that fresh air needs to make it all the way into here, and as it's making it into here, it's got the hot gases going out over top of it. At that interface, they're kind of mixing together. So you're not exactly getting 21% oxygen right away into this fire. It's mixing. You might get 19, 18, 17% in here. It doesn't grow as fast. But when you vent right at that seat of the fire, that's where you're getting your 60-second, 90-second, 120-second flashover times. You're giving it right where it wants it. But if we put water on it before we get to those time frames, then it goes out and the heat leaves. And you do exactly what your ventilation was intended to do. You've got to coordinate it. Reading smoke. I gave you a quick glimpse of this earlier. Ventilation limited fire, it's pushing out every little crack that it can find around our window plugs, around our doorway. It's going to start changing from gray to white. So if we're reading colors, we might be getting some mixed messages. and we lose a lot of our visual cues. How many people have responded to smoke in the area, found smoke in an area, had a house on fire, but the house on fire really didn't have much showing whatsoever?
And too late.
Too lately.
Like that.
So it's, the other piece of this, because the attic space is vented, a lot of times you might get lazy smoke coming out of the eaves or out of the roof line. That's because that is not, it's an open space. So if smoke leaks into the attic space, it's continuing to slowly leak out because of the ventilation in the attic space. So you might only have smoke showing from the eave line. Doesn't automatically mean you have an attic fire. It means probably you have a ventilation limited fire in the living space. When you pop the front door, this is probably the best insight you have to what's going on. Pay a lot of attention when you pop that front door. If you get smoke pulling in past you low and fresh air going in at about 10 to 15 miles per hour, you have a ventilation limited fire. Fire acts like a pump. It pulls fresh air, pushes out hot gases. That fire is ventilation limited, the faster it's going to pull that air in. So if for some reason you're thinking, all right, I'm searching ahead of the hose line on this one, and that front door gets popped, and it starts pulling in, you probably want to think of either that's not the fire to do that on, or get some door control going. It also tells you a lot about potentially what the level of the fire is. Because, again, the fire is a pump. It wants to create a neutral plane. So if you pop that front door and the smoke stays at the ground, you might have a basement fire. You pop that front door and the smoke lifts and makes a tunnel right here, you probably have fire on the first floor. If you pop that front door and you've got smoke filling your front door that immediately lifts to the top of the doorway, the fire is probably above you. A lot you can learn from that front door. But again, you've got to watch for a second and slow yourself down and read the conditions. You can't just pop it and go running right through the front door. If this is a good indication of what's going on, take the second to look at it. The other thing you're going to notice is, with the fire being a pump, and it starts recirculating smoke and creating a tunnel, that airflow is going to where the fire is. If you have a charged hose line and you're ready to go, it's leading you right to the seat of the fire in many cases. The other thing you need to realize is, this is just creating a tunnel between you and where the fire is in some cases. It's not lifting the smoke in the rest of the house. The back rooms don't have smoke that automatically lifts up off the floor. This is also temporary. As that pulls in, as soon as that oxygen mixes with that fire, you're now losing the battle again. It's creating more energy and more smoke than you're letting out. So if you go ahead and start to ride that tunnel in, and you don't get to the scene of the fire, you're going to lose your visibility, and your tunnel's going to go away, and you're going to black out on you. Then the question is, what's going to win? The amount of fire coming over your head to go to the low pressure of that flow path? Or your water moving in to knock that fire down. One of the more reasons that you need to be controlling the fire from the moment that you go through that front door. One of the things that I like is, how many old guys in here, how many younger guys have been told by the old guys, I want an ear exposed, I want a wrist exposed, I want something exposed so I can get an idea of what the conditions are. Well, I don't want to give up a piece of my body, but I've got a tool that I can use to get an idea of what the conditions are. It's called water. Shoot water ahead of you up into the hot gas layer. If it turns to steam, what do we know? It's over 212 degrees and it's doing work for you. It's taking energy away. You throw water up ahead of you, all falls to the ground, no steam. It's less than 212 degrees, I can keep moving. You also have a 40 or 50 foot reach of your hose string. I can hit almost every piece of this first floor from within the first 10 feet of that front doorway. I can get a really good indication of what part of the house is making steam and what part isn't by sweeping my hose line across that floor. Coordination. I've harped on this enough. It's extremely important that we coordinate our ventilation with our fire suppression. You have to ventilate. However, it can't be alone. You aren't going to control a fire purely by ventilating alone. The amount of energy that you're going to allow to be increased, you need to take away with that hose tree. Vent enter search. And then what I've gotten beat up and ridiculed about and everything else is you add the word isolate in there and all of a sudden you're a horrible person. You learn real quickly by traveling the country that a whole lot of people weren't even considering closing that door, while many others say, I've been closing that door forever. You've got to isolate the flow path. Here's a video of a test we did in Governor's Island where we've got a fire on the first floor, two bedrooms on the second floor, closed bedroom, open bedroom. We go ahead, we take the closed bedroom. You don't get a huge push of smoke out of there. Right off the bat, if you vent that window, you know that door is closed. That is not in the flow path. That low pressure you made isn't a low pressure because it's not connected to where the fire is. When we go ahead and take the other window to the open bedroom, to a ventilation limited fire on the first floor, air low, hot gas is out high. Different story, right? We remotely pull that door shut. That's what that burp of smoke just was. And the smoke's going to go ahead and it's going to begin to lift out of that room. Gave it 30 seconds before we pulled it shut. All right, there it's shut. So now the smoke's lifting in the room. And you went ahead and you cut the flow path. And it actually pisses the fire off on the first floor because it was awful happy sending its hot stuff up high. See how quickly that happened? When do you want to start that clock ticking? You want to start that clock ticking and make that clock as short as you possibly can between the time that that window breaks and that door shuts. So does that mean go ahead and throw your tip of the ladder through the window and start your VES before you've got your gloves and you're breathing air and ready to go through? No. As cool as it feels to throw a ladder through a window, your best bet is to set it at the sill, be ready to go, be ready to isolate that door and conduct your search. Pop it, see whether or not you have opened or closed. Go ahead, get to that door, get that door secured. And from all the tests we've done, you've got at least 5 minutes with a fully involved fire on the other side of the door before that door burns through. Should be a decent amount of time to finish your search, and God forbid you find somebody, give you enough time to get them out. Here's what that looked like. With the door open, it was 450 degrees at 7 feet and 170 degrees at 1 foot. You can handle this 170. So as awful as that looked like with all that black smoke blowing out through that window, you can actually make it in there. You're going to get awful hot awful fast. But if you get that door shut, look what it did. 450 to 150, 170 to 120, and it cut the flow off. So you're not going to feel like you're in a convection oven anymore.
Steve?
Yes?
You have...
We do. I don't have them on here, but we will when we put out the report. Of course, you can see the top of the stair temperature there. You cut that flow off, and you actually improve conditions on the entire second floor. Best chance of victim and firefighter survival is behind a closed door. Here's the, during all the vertical ventilation tests, here's the time to incapacitation or victims being overcome by CO and by temperature, an average of all the tests between the open and closed bedrooms. So open here, 7 to 8 minutes. Here, never happened in the 20-minute test. Here, open bedroom, 8 to 12 minutes. In the open bedroom, closed bedroom, never got there in 20 minutes. And if everything goes bad on you and you've got to bail out, I know the last thing you want to be doing is stopping and closing a door, but maybe we need to start thinking about that when we start talking about bailing out and seeking refuge and giving yourself time to actually use your PSS or your escape rope or things like that. And ultimately, the rest of this class is to make sure you don't have to do this. Vertical ventilation, I'm going to touch on this a little bit. We're wrapping up the study now. Got my partner in crime, Julie, in the back. Julie, put your hand up. Julie's the person responsible for making all of the online training programs. So she's got to take all the weird stuff I write on paper and figure out how to make it interactive and alive and cool videos and things like that, so it's not just a boatload of graphs. So what we have here is we've got a fire in the living room, and on the left, we're going to go ahead and make a 4x4 hole, and on the right, we're going to make a 4x8 hole. Front door's going to get opened. Once it hits 400 degrees at 3 feet, vertical vent opens. And there's a number of important learnings here.
Modern furnishings.
See them both go ventilation limited, ventilation limited, ventilation limited. I've got a pretty cool rig set up here, so I don't need to put firefighters on the roof. I've got a pulley system that allows a flap to be open to simulate cutting the roof. I've got a section of ceiling inside hooked to a forklift over here that I pull out of the way, simulating popping the ceiling down. So that's why you're going to see a delay from when the roof gets open until the ceiling gets pushed, until the smoke starts coming through the attic space. Attic space is non-combustible. That just would have made things worse. And I got to try and get multiple tests out of these things. If I burn the attic off, I'd only be able to do it once. So they grow a little bit differently. You got a little bit of a head start over here than we do over here. Slow it down to real time. So we got our 4x4 opened up over here. They're going to pull, get the 4x8 open. It got hung up a little bit. Don't pay attention to him falling on his ass. We got the 4x4 opened up over here. See, we're now we go ahead and we push our ceiling through. There's some training manuals out there and some books that have been written. Have said that you don't need to coordinate your vertical ventilation because everything goes up and out and things always get better. So here's 16 square feet of hole, our normal 4x4, and you can see we still have so much fuel and this is still underventilated, so now we get fire out of the roof, plus we still have fire coming out of that living room. We certainly did not lift the smoke layer and make things better purely with that vertical ventilation by itself. Over here, we've got a little less fire coming out of the front, but even though we've got 32 square feet of vertical vent up on the roof, it's still flashed over, it's still fully involved, we're still ventilation limited. You need to coordinate your vertical ventilation with your fire attack. And again, just like the horizontal, the closer you provide the air, and the closer you provide the hot gases leaving, the quicker you create the perfect scenario to grow that fire. You also create the perfect scenario to let the hot gases out after you knock the fire down. Again, we're teaching the second half, right? Always vent close to the scene of the fire as you can. Well, assuming you're putting water on the fire. Need to coordinate it. Doesn't take long to go from vertical vent with low inlet to full flashover, overwhelming the vents. But the moment you put water on that, and we'll show this in a number of experiments, the better things get, the faster things get better. There's also a few things that that will come out in the report, because I'm still working with Julie to make them really cool visually, because they're pretty complex. In some cases, when you vent remote from the scene of the fire, you can actually make a big portion of the house better by venting remote from the scene of the fire. Because you go ahead, and if you have a bedroom fire, and the only source of oxygen that bedroom fire has is a single doorway, you can only generate so much energy because it's limited by how much air it can pull through the door. So if you can let more out on one side of the house than the fire is creating in the bedroom, you can make the living room and the path from the front door to the bedroom better, temporarily. So all the stuff we're seeing with vertical ventilation, where it allowed the engine company to get to the seat of the fire, what we're doing is we're allowing that engine company to ride that flow path to the fire and giving them a little more lift remote from the fire that gets them there to put water on it. The tipping point is, as soon as the fire comes out of the room and starts going to the vertical vent, if it catches another piece of furniture on fire, now we flash that room over, and now we made things worse. So it all comes down to timing. You time your vertical vent right, and in some cases, we're doing this all the time. We're not necessarily venting right over the fire in a single family home. We're probably picking a spot near the peak in the center of the house and open that up. And if we punch down into an area that isn't where the fire is, in many cases, you might be making a better situation for a piece of the house. But it's really important the water gets put on that fire before that fire comes out of that room and ignites another fuel package. Because then you're not limiting the air anymore. You just gave it a whole other set of potential energy to get involved. And the online training program, Julie will have that interactive. She's got some pretty neat stuff where you can open different vents and different size fires get created and you see the flow paths and things like that. So we're excited to get that out in June. Operational time frame. This goes to the collapse stuff in basement fires. I'm going to hit basement fires real quick. Whether it was dimensional lumber, engineered I-joists, castellated I-joists with the cutouts, hybrid trusses, steel C-joists, metal plate connected wood trusses, whether it was furnace tests, lab tests, field tests, real houses, whatever it was, all of the collapse times occurred within the operational time frame of the fire department. And in many cases, before your arrival. So there's probably 30 tests here that are all collapsing, in many cases, before the 11-minute mark. Many of them down in the 3, 4, 5-minute mark. Even the dimensional lumber, the average was less than 15 minutes. Those are unfinished basements.
So what's the time difference if the code was to be changed and just put a single sheet of drywall there?
We did change the code.
Is it an hour? Yeah.
No, it's an extra 15 minutes if you're lucky. So again, still potentially in your operational time frame. Thermal imaging cameras. You get a basement fire below you. Wood is a very good insulator. Carpet is a very good insulator. Your thermal imaging camera is giving you surface temperatures. We had any number of tests where we had 1,200 to 13 to 2,000 degrees below the floor and 73 degrees on the top of the carpet. Unless there is an opening between that basement to the first floor, like a floor vent that had duct work burned through, or outlets, or whatever the case may be, holes for radiators and things like that, that's where you're going to see that you've got a fire below. So no indication that you've got a fire underneath this floor. They go ahead and pop a hole through it and see that they've got fire below that floor. So you got to be very deceiving if you're relying on your thermal imaging camera. It can also be extremely deceiving to use sounding with a tool to say that you have a solid floor. Go back one more. This piece of wood right here stays intact for a fair amount of time. And this has carpet on it. If you've got hardwood, if you've got tile, any other floor covering you have on there, and you sound it, it is going to sound solid. In many cases, especially with these engineered systems, they are going to catastrophically collapse wall to wall and not just collapse in a hole. If you have an open basement, chances are you're not going to develop a hole between the basement and the first floor. You're going to drop a section of floor that's going to sound awful solid. And in many cases, you're not going to feel a sag, because your indication of sag is one hand compared to the other hand. It's only 3 feet. Even if it's sagging 8 inches on a 20-foot span, you're not going to notice a difference of 1 or 2 inches between your hands as you're crawling over that. So there's very few guarantees or extremely reliable signs that you're about to fall into a basement fire. There isn't any of them. That's why you're going to start seeing a whole bunch of suggestions of controlling that fire, not by crawling on top of it, by getting water in below it, or through a walkout, or through a window, or whatever the case is. Because if I'm going to fall into a basement, I'd rather fall into a soggy, humid one than one that's fully involved in fire. Can't emphasize the 360 size up enough to locate your basement fires. What we saw in every test was where the fire started in the basement, or where the fire got ventilation in the basement, is where the collapse occurred. So if you're doing a 360 and you've got fire coming out of the windows in the CD corner, that first floor that's going to collapse is most likely in the CD corner. So if for whatever reason you've got crews operating that area or trying to find the stairs in that area, that's a good piece of information to relay. Ventilation flow paths. This is more important in basement fires than anywhere else. Anywhere you've got fire going from one level to the next, heat rises, folks. It's going to want to come out of that basement, and it wants to go up the chimney, which is the stairwell, and it wants to go to a low pressure. So if you've got that front door open, that is your low pressure. Most of the time when we force the front door open and we go to find the stairs of a basement fire, you automatically put yourself in the flow path if that basement doorway is open. You're now betting your life that the glass in that basement is going to hold so that you don't wind up in the flow path. If that glass fails and that fire gets air low and hot gases out where you are, not a good situation. This is front door open. Not much happens, right? Nothing's going on in the basement of the first floor. The moment we open those basement windows, we're looking at temperature increases going from about 500 degrees to 1800 degrees in that flow path between the basement and the front door in very short order. 10, 20, 30 seconds. Here's a video that shows that natural tendency for the fire to follow the flow path. Here's the basement, and we've got some pallets and some boxes of styrofoam to simulate what you would have in your basement as storage. You see that the fire gets in the combustible floor, and the first place it wants to go is follow the path of least resistance and go up that stairwell. Here's the top of the stairs. That's where it wants to go. It's got windows and a door open at the basement level. So the fire's not going to the doors and the window right away. It wants to go up. So it's going up to the first floor. And what you're going to see is, once that floor system gets involved, it overwhelms the vent. And now you've got fire coming out of 3 windows and a door and blowtorching up the stairwell. So if you go around and you vent the basement, assuming that you're going to make it so your crews can get down the stairs and make things better for them, you're actually doing the opposite. You want to make sure that that ventilation doesn't get done in that basement, unless you're going to go ahead and attack it from the basement. Now we've got any number of people here that have probably made the stairs of a basement fire. It's timing. So if you've got a small fire that snuffed itself out and was taking a while to build back up, you're not going to have an issue. You're going to make those stairs no problem. If you get windows that don't fail, you're going to make those stairs no problem. But now, it's like Russian roulette, right? You're rolling the dice, hoping that as windows don't fail or another crew doesn't take out those windows so that you don't get put in that flow path. Risk you want to take.
Wouldn't be worth it to break out the windows and spray some water and cool the atmosphere, would it?
We'll talk about that next. Here we're looking at a just a fire scene showing the natural flow path from the basement out the front door. You give it somewhere to go, it will go there. So this stuff doesn't only happen in our tests, I promise you. So some guys are deciding that finding the stairs is not the right option anymore. We've got any number of line of duty desks where we can see that these events have happened, and in many cases they had charged hose lines. Now let's look at protecting the stairs. So now we're going to go ahead and our SOP says first enter door to the top of the stairs to protect the stairs. We've got a working basement fire, we've got the door open. Take 180 gallon per minute smooth bore at the top of those stairs, and we're going to go ahead and protect the stairs. One thing you should notice is that we're really not doing anything to this fire in the basement, because the water can't go down the stairs, make a right-hand turn, make a left-hand turn, and go to where the fire is. It can only absorb the energy and create steam in the area that it's being flowed. So we're making one heck of a amount of steam and hot gases there, but we're not doing anything about that fire in the basement that's now burning unchecked. So what does that look like? Well, while that water was flowing, in this case it was 25 seconds of water, the conditions at the top of the stairs got cooled from about 600 degrees to 400 degrees. So we're protecting that one area. Bedroom upstairs went from 225 to 210, so we're kind of protecting the upstairs. However, really not efficiently. The basement continues to grow. Basement's awful happy. It's going to continue to grow. It's got air coming in from a couple directions. Heat flux you cut down because you've got a whole bunch of water cutting off that heat. One of the problems we saw was that in every basement fire test we did, the fire extension from the basement to the first floor was not through the open stairwell. It was through the kitchen pipe chases. So the fire went up into the kitchen cabinets and essentially flashed the kitchen over. While the kitchen was flashing over, the floor of the kitchen was also collapsing. Here you can see a picture of the floor collapse. That's the basement window. That's the kitchen cabinets screwed to the wall. Floor's gone. Here.
Fire under the kitchen seat?
Fire was under the kitchen.
It was in all those cases?
Not all of them. In some cases it was in the same side of the structure, just in the back corner, not the front corner. So here you can see the layout. We've got a crew stretching a hose line to protect the stairs here. That flashover can occur behind them, cutting off their egress back the way they came in, potentially catching them off guard. And if more than the kitchen area collapsed and the hallway collapsed, then they're in a bad spot. Here we talk about the floor sag. You might not necessarily feel it. Water in the basement window. We're getting right down to the end here, last few slides. We're looking for a big push of heat up this stairwell door. Once that water goes in. Water just started. You actually get the opposite. It actually absorbs energy, cools it off, and you don't get a huge flow up through those stairs because you're taking it from 2,000 degrees down to 200 degrees. There's a huge amount of contraction of gases, when it drops 1,500 degrees. In some cases, it actually is enough to almost balance out the expansion of the steam.
I have a question here.
One second. Let me get to the end of this, and then we'll do some questions. So here you can see temperatures at the top of the stairs, 600 degrees down to 200 degrees. That's the area we're trying to protect, right? Bedroom dropped from 225 to 190. You had a better impact on those bedroom conditions by putting water in the basement than you did by holding the stairs. Water in a window, we'll skip this one. There's a disc at the NIST booth that has this on it. They ran out? They ran out? Very good, all right. We'll get more made. Softening the target. 25 gallons of water off the ceiling of the second floor bedroom that's flashed over. We're worried about the hallway, right? We don't want to go ahead and push fire into anyone that might be in that hallway. 10 seconds after water, 25 gallons of water off the ceiling, we dropped the bedroom fire from 1,800 degrees to 600 degrees, and the hallway went from 273 to 104 degrees at the 3-foot mark. We're not forcing the fire through, we're knocking the fire down. 4 points to consider when we start talking about pushing fire. And all of the people that have been opposite a hose line for whatever reason, in many cases, they're changing the flow path with ventilation. So if you're opposite a hose line, you came into that structure somehow. And in many cases, we're not appreciating the fact that we created a low pressure behind ourselves. And the fire is going to start moving to that low pressure anyway, regardless of what the hose stream does. And if the fire comes back over your head, it's going to do that anyway, whether there's water or not. So in some cases, the timing gets mixed up. Was it the water? Was it the ventilation? What was it? Another piece is saturation of gear. At what point are you so full of energy in your turnout gear that it's going to begin to start passing it on to your body? There might be some impact of steam there. I'm not sure. We need to look at that further. The change of flow path with water. One of the things we saw that was really interesting is if you take the smoothbore and you whip it in a circle and you create a fog pattern and you entrain a bunch of air, you can absolutely move heat into that window. Because you took something that was venting out, and even though you knocked the fire down, everything that's going on here is now moving in because you're entraining air to seal that window. One of the best things you can do is get your solid stream or your straight stream at a high angle, close to the sill, off the ceiling in the room, to continue to allow that hot gases and steam to vent back out the way they want to vent out, the closest point, and don't force them into the structure. Give it the best chance to come back out the way it wants to come out. Don't seal it up. And don't open a fog pattern, because that's going to move enough air that's going to seal that outlet. And if you seal the outlet, it's going to find somewhere else to go. I don't have to tell you guys about the complexity, all the things you need to be thinking about when you arrive. It's a great time. All these people are coming together. We've got some funding. And this is the piece I want you to take away. We have SOGs. We train on them. We apply them in incidents. We critique. We revise them. And we make better SOPs. without the knowledge of fire dynamics as our foundation, all we're doing is we're guessing in circles because we don't necessarily know why. We don't understand if the back door was open, if the back door wasn't open, how's that going to change what I saw? I might blame it on one thing and not do that one thing again when that one thing may have been correct. One thing that we have going for us now is, if you've got a good knowledge of fire dynamics, you're gaining experience which you actually understand. And when you gain experience you understand, you get better as firefighters and fire officers. I want to steal that good experience, input it into my fire research, and give you more information that you can put in your standard operating procedures to go ahead and throw it in that loop so you can continually improve. And that's where we're going.